Okay, so this talk is all about optimizing under Palm's 3D hardware. So of course, today, pretty much our only approach is through the PDK. But as time goes by, obviously, you guys are going to have more options. And I'm sure you guys can read between the lines. I already know probably what's in the website of way of doing some 3D stuff. And I'm Christopher Tremblay. I'm a principal engineer at Palm. And I work in graphics and in games as well. So who should be here? So the general path is if you have a suit, then you can probably leave. And I think everyone's pretty much OK on this count here. The other thing, too, is this is the stuff that we're actually going to talk about today a bit more in depth. And the biggest thing, really, is we want to get questions from you guys to say, hey, well, I'm doing this project. What's slowing me down or things like that? So that's the biggest thing for you guys is as you go through this, you might want to think about questions that you might want to ask at the end. But in the meantime, we'll go through some of the basic stuff that you guys might already know, but also a bit more Palm specific. So the type of stuff we're going to talk about are we're going to look at the hardware specs. We're going to look at 3D versus 2D. And we're going to look at GLES 1 versus 2. Some of these kind of seem obvious, but you guys are going to see that as we go through this, they're not as obvious, or there's other things that get into it that makes it a little more challenging in terms of just choosing one or the other. So we're going to talk about also features between the Pre and the Pixie so that you guys can write code that'll go across all of the Palm hardware platform without getting into any issues. The desktop emulation story, we're going to talk about 3D frameworks at the very end. And then we're going to go to questions and answers. So the next step, so we're going to go under the hood. So again, if you got a suit, then. So here's the Palm Pre. So if we just look at the specs, this is more or less what it is. So the Palm Pre is a Cortex A8. It runs at 600 megahertz. And as part of the Cortex A8, what you get is you get the Neon SIMD. So you get the ability to work with multiple registers if you guys want to go all the way down to the assembly level. You also get VFP, which basically means you got accelerated floating point on that unit. For the graphics chip, it's an Imaginations graphics chip. It runs at 110 megahertz. And it's specifically the Imagination SGX 530. So the other things that the Pre has is it has 256 megs of RAM. But if you guys are running the Pixie, the Pre Plus, you actually get double that. So that's a little thing to keep in mind. If you're actually targeting something lower, then 256 is what you're going to target. 8 gigs of flash, then you got the screen resolutions, 320 by 480. And the other important part that some people don't know is it's actually 24 bits per pixel. So you can get the full resolution of the RGB and on the Pre. It recognizes up to 5 fingers. So if you guys do multi-touch, then that's what you should be looking for. Camera's 3.2 megapixels. And it's a 3-axis accelerometer. So that means you can get the X, the Y, and the Z-axis all together. Here's the Pixie. So the Pixie's slightly different, but actually quite similar. So there's been a lot of talk about Pixie being slower and things like that. But in reality, it's actually running a 600 megahertz processor, which is the same as Castle. The big difference that you'll see on the Pixie, however, is on the graphics chips. It's actually running a Qualcomm Adreno 200. And that runs at 92 megahertz. So the CPU's pretty much the same, just one. Instead of ARM v7, you're actually looking at ARM v6. And it's, of course, the architecture is slightly different. So you get a bit of a perf gain on Castle on Pre for having the processor there, even though it runs at the same speed. But the GPU is actually quite better. So that's something to keep in mind there. The one thing that will slow you down is on the Pixie, you've got only 256 megs of RAM. So when you're looking at the Pre, it has the same amount. The only difference is that on the Pixie, the modem uses a bit more memory. So when you actually look at how much memory is freely available for you as a developer on the Pixie, you'll see that it's a bit less. So that's why some people will tend to say that the Pixie's a little slower is because it's got a bit less memory, and it has to swap a little more. So again, another thing to keep in mind. Resolution, you've got 80 pixels less. And the other thing, too, is that the color depth, it's 18 bits. So the tricky part, it's a bit more trickier with the color depths here, so 6-bit versus the full 8-bit. Same as Pre for this. You can recognize it as up to 5 fingers. It has a 3-axis accelerometer. Camera's 2 megapixels. Oh, and while I'm at it, the only difference between the Pixie and the Pixie Plus is pretty much just right there. It has the Wi-Fi. So that's pretty much the only difference you guys need to be concerned about. So here's a couple of statistics that you guys might be interested in if you actually go and dwell into a 3D game, so or 3D application in general. So when we look at how many pixels per clock that you can do, you'll see that the pre here actually tends to do a little less pixels per clock than the pixie, which again is an indication of the surely the frequency that it runs at. So pixie does better in terms of just pushing pixels out. On the shader clock, what you'll notice is it's pretty much the same picture again. So this one runs at about 110, and this one runs at about 300 and some. And as you look at the other things too, you can see shaders per operation. So if you guys are doing really complex OpenGL 2.0 shaders, you'll get a much better bang for your buck on the Pixie. It just literally tears up the pre. Here's the part that probably is more restrictive about graphics is the memory bandwidth. So as you look at that, you'll see that you're going to be quite limited by your memory bandwidth. Even though the Pixie can do really good in terms of operations, it's pretty good at math, but it's not so good at doing fancy texture fetches or combining things in operations. So in general, this is probably where you're going to be limited by. Then we've also got some other more interesting stuff, like the texture fill rate if you use the nearest and if you use the linear. And the one interesting thing to notice here is that for Pixie, whether you're using nearest or linear, really isn't that much of a difference. If you look on the pre, however, nearest is a huge gain over using linear when you use your texture sampling. So again, that's more stuff to keep in mind. And then we also looked at the transfer rate and the rate at which you can upload textures. And this is, interestingly, the only part where the pre does beat the Pixie is when you call GL, when you upload a texture, you actually, it's slightly faster. So just interesting tidbits on that part. Yeah, please.
Are those theoretical values?
No, those are absolutely measured.
Whoa, really?
Those are measured values. So those are not theoretical. We don't care about theoretical, to be honest with you. Yeah, absolutely. The theoretical is what we saw at the beginning, the frequency and, but that's not really theoretical. It's also the real frequency, mind you, but yes.
Those were benchmarked.
Absolutely. Those were measured by us, not by the vendors also. So they're as reliable as we can make them. Here's the interesting question now. So, is it worth it to be 2D or not 2D? So a lot of people think, hey, we have this fancy 3D graphics chip. Why not use that to do my 2D game, which might be, an emulator or any of that stuff? Well, it's actually not that black and white. A lot of people are really easy to jump to the gun and say, I'm just going to use the 3D chip. It's going to make my game faster just to use that versus using some 2D, software blitz, literally. It's not that simple, again, because when we look back at the frequency, as you've seen, the CPU frequencies are quite high. They're 600 megahertz. And then you go back and look at the GPU, and they're, 200 and 110. So it's not that black and white to say that one is faster than the other. The thing that you get on the GPU is that you get parallelism. So because of that, it's a little more, you can't just compare eggs to eggs. So in general, here's the type of thing we tend to look at is, if you have an app that does a lot of render draw calls, you have a lot of little textures, a lot of sprites maybe, it's an RPG or something like that, you have a lot of those, then you're actually a lot better on the CPU because GPUs are not good at having a lot of draw calls. So that's one thing you can look at. The other thing too is if you require a lot of pixel manipulation, so suppose you do one of those tank war games and you need to read pixels very efficiently, obviously that's not very good for the GPU. The GPU is good at pushing a lot of data through, not so good at reading data back. So that's one thing to look for as well. And then, of course, if you need to do something that's really fancy, really has a lot of glitz, a lot of sparks, a lot of glitter, then you're very much likely going to be better using an OpenGL-ES standard because that's going to be able to push a lot more math through than the CPU would be able to. But so the general rule is if all you need to do is just blitz sprites in 2D, most likely the CPU will be better. That's one thing we found ourselves in our own UI, too, is when we look at the blit performance, actually, our software engine ends up being just about faster or about equivalent to running an OpenGL version of that. So it's definitely stuff to look at. The other benefit, however, to running a GPU is you might free up some CPU. So if you guys end up being CPU limited, then the GPU might be an attractive solution. So again, there's no black and white, but there's a lot of things to consider. Don't just jump straight to the 3D bandwagon and say, this is going to win. So the other interesting aspect that we can look at is OpenGL 1 versus 2. So you guys may or not know what the feature difference is, but for GL 1 and GL 2, the big difference is in 2, you pretty much have to do everything yourself. You really have the nuts and the bolts. So you have to end up writing all the shaders to do basic stuff. The matrix math is not for free anymore. You actually have to go in there, and you have to do all of that yourself, pretty much. So as you go about that, if you're not so much knowledgeful about the internals of a graphic engine, then most likely you want to stick to the OpenGL 1.x, because that's going to give you the biggest and easiest path to getting your stuff up and running. Now, if you need the flexibility of the shaders, then there's no contest there. You just go straight to the 2.x. So the question is this, the Pixie graphic card is 2.x compatible? Yes, so both the Pre and the Pixie, they're both running the 2.0 and the 1.0. So you guys are not 0, but 1.x, I'm sorry. But yes, they both support the same API as far as GL is concerned. Okay, so I'll repeat the question, just make sure I understand it. So the question is, if we're forward-looking about the application we're making, what should we target?
Yes, minimum hardware configuration.
Yeah, minimum hardware configuration. So if you're looking at a hardware that's tomorrow, so to speak, we can't really give you any details about that, obviously. But if you wanted to run on everything that runs today, then the Pre are pretty much similar in terms of what they offer. But for the Pre platform, you can easily target the 2.0 if you like. But again, you could target the 1.0 if it ends up being more efficient for you. So I don't think there's a straight question to say this is the minimum bar. As far as the specification, if you look at the specs that I showed at the beginning, however, you'll notice that you can assume that we're at least going to run at 600 megahertz. Right? I don't think anyone's going to ship anything that's slower than that in the future, for sure. And then the memory, you can also look at that. It's 256 is your baseline, so you can expect no less than that in the future. So I think in terms of, if you just look at what there is today, you can probably extrapolate and say we're not going to go down and back in time. We're actually going to go up. The screen size are going to go better. The memory frequency is going to get better. You're going to get more RAM. Without giving any details that I can't give out right now, it's about as good as a question. Does that answer your question? Sure, okay. So the question is whether we actually use a compatibility layer for the 2.0, or for the 1.0, I'm sorry, for the 1.x, using 2.x. So no, basically, we actually, internally in the hardware, there are optimizations that can be done if you don't implement the 1.x directly on top of the 2.x. So you have access to more of the internals of the system. So with that in mind, the 1.x can actually be more efficient than the 2.x because of that, because it's not a 1.x implemented on top of a 2.x implementation. So that's another thing to keep in mind in the previous slide. If you're looking at, should I go OpenGL 1, OpenGL 2, then 1's a bit more efficient if you're sticking to the stuff that 1 does. Okay. So here's a couple of other interesting things. Again, most people are interested in making code that actually runs everywhere, right? It kind of sucks to have to implement all this if-def code and pound defines and various things like that. So I've put up here a couple of things that I've seen to be differences between Pre and Pixie that might be of interest to some of you guys, one of which is texture compression. So texture compression is pretty heavily used in games, at least in general, because it saves a lot of memory bandwidth. So instead of sending full 32-bit textures, for instance, you end up sending much less memory back and forth, so it ends up being more efficient. So that's a pretty big feature. So both Pre and Pixie support the ETC OES format, so not a problem there. The problem, however, is that ETC does not support alpha, and that's where kind of everything crumbles. So because we have two different vendors here, Pixie is coming from an ATI, AMD, Qualcomm world, and the Pre comes from the imagination world, they actually don't support any common texture compression for textures with alpha built into them. However, they do support their own proprietary extensions. So if you guys actually want to go and say, well, if this is a Pixie, I'm going to do this, and if it's a Pre, then I'm going to do the other compression, then you're free to do that. But unfortunately, there's no means. And we are actively working to trying to get the Chrono Standard Group to push something that's a bit more standardized so that the developers don't have to feel the pain of this texture compression scheme. Sure.
Now, isn't the Pre one that's based on the tile rendering processor with S3TC, right?
So the question is whether the Pre?
Yeah.
The Pre is a tiler-based processor. Yes, absolutely. The imagination is a tiler-based processor. Okay, so the other thing that might be of interest, too, is non-power of 2. So as far as the 2.0 spec goes, non-powers of 2 are supported, but they're only partially supported. That being said, it means that the repeat mode and the mirror mode are both not supported as the GL standard. There are extensions, however, with the OES where you can use the repeat and the mirror mode. However, only the Pixie supports the repeat mode and not the pre. So if you're planning to use something where you can just use a texture and just have it repeat over a certain length, then it's not going to work if you use power of two textures. I'm sorry, non-power of two textures. Other thing of interest, VBO versus VBA, so that's vertex buffer objects and vertex buffer arrays. So vertex buffer objects are actually more efficient on Pixie, as a lot of people would expect. Whether they're dynamic or static, they'll be more efficient either way. On the pre, however, vertex buffer arrays end up being more efficient. And again, this is not theoretical. This is all stuff we've computed. We've actually gone in there, and this is stuff we've come out with. So yeah, this sucks a little bit, but in the worst case, you guys can probably, at the very least, abstract whether you're using vertex buffer arrays or vertex buffer objects within an object in C++. The other thing to look at is shader binary. That's something in general that we don't really recommend because, again, we have different vendors. So if you try to compile a shader in binary mode and just try to load it back up, then you're not going to get a great experience because you're going to have to write two different paths of code, one for Pixie, one for pre, and one for any other piece of hardware that you might have to support that's neither imagination or Qualcomm's code. And then last but not least, the pack depth stencil buffer. So there's this nice thing in GL where you can actually pack both the depth and the stencil buffer into one 32-bit value. And it's quite efficient, again, because you're using less memory. The problem, again, is that the Pixie supports that, the pre does not. So if that's of any consideration, then that's the story on that. And just a little blurb here on the desktop simulation. So some of you folks might have tried to just run this code that you have on the desktop. So the nice thing about the desktop is that it's not an emulator, and in a twisted sense, it's also not a simulator. You actually compile the code directly for desktop. In a sense, you could easily just publish your game for desktop the way it runs, because it literally runs just as an application on its own. So the stack is pretty much all the same. Of course, the CPUs end up being different, the graphics chips and the kernels. But at the end of the day, SDL tends to abstract pretty much all the stuff that you do not really care about at the end of the day. The one part that's a bit different in terms of code that you guys need to write is GLI. So GLI is a bit of a problem child that came about because Microsoft didn't care about OpenGL anymore. So the one thing in Windows is that the OpenGL library is quite dated. It's actually like a 1.x OpenGL library. And in fact, OpenGL is now at the 4.0. So basically, because of that, then everyone needs to go and call all of the OpenGL extensions just to get everything that's new. So anything that's new in the 2.x, you have to go in and say, well, I'll go and read that through an extension. So it's really painful for developers to run that because they have to go and say, well, I'd like the pointer to this function, please get it. And you have to do that for every function. So GLI does that all that magic for you. So it goes in, and it has a list of all those function pointers, and it gets all of the function pointers for that for you. So you don't have to muck with that. In OpenGL-ES, you don't have to worry about that at all. But for the desktop, you do have to worry about that. So that's why GLI is there, and you'll notice that in the code, if you guys attended Aaron's talk this morning, he probably showed you guys that little blurb of code that you have to write just to initialize GLI. So beyond that, that's pretty much the only difference that you'll have to do. And our goal, again, is that you guys end up having to write the code once and that you can publish on any other platform that SDL supports. Right now, today, there's a couple things stopping us from doing that because of GLI. But as we're looking over for the next gen of SDL, you guys are going to notice that all that stuff that makes it platform-specific is going to go away, and you guys are going to be able to basically do stuff like, yeah, without having any if-defs is our hope. Yes? Okay, so the question is, what do I mean by the next gen of SDL? 1.3, yeah, and it's also actually going to be a 2.0. 1.3 is the internal name, but yes, so we're looking at, and we also are working with Sam Latinga of SDL to push some of the stuff that we'd like to push for some of the common requests, basically, that are not supported today with SDL. And we're also not afraid, as you guys have seen in the past, there's a couple of things in our version of SDL that are also not in the 1.2. Namely, in our version of SDL, you can select whether you'd like to use OpenGL 1 or 2. That's not an SDL 1.2 thing. That's actually something that's an SDL 1.3 thing that we've backported to 1.2. So as time goes, we're also going to look at some of that stuff to bring more features to you guys in general. So then the other last question is, what type of 3D framework can we support? Moreover, we can support pretty much any type of framework. At GDC, we announced that we actually had their Unreal Tournament engine running with the demo on our platform. The other thing that can easily run, too, is the Ogre, the open source engine. There's Irlich, also open source, Edgelib, and Unity. So there's really not much of a restrictions. A lot of people have had pretty much a very easy time porting their iPhone apps, for instance, over to our platform. As long as you guys don't use Objective-C code too heavily, then it tends to be pretty easy to transfer apps over. And then last but not least, if you guys have any more questions, I tend to personally troll the forums myself. So you can go to developer.palm.com and feel free to ask questions in the forum, whatever comes up to mind, or if you guys have any, you know, your code isn't running or whatever issues might come up, it's a great place to be at. So any more additional questions? Sure, please. How well is our support for Cocoa 2D? So you mean Cocoa the Apple Cocoa?
No, it's an open source framework that
kind of OpenGL. OK, so as far as Cocoa, I'm not familiar with Cocoa myself, but as long as it uses OpenGL-ES, and that's the bit of the caveat. Sure, I understand that, but you're saying it uses OpenGL, correct? So as long as it uses OpenGL-ES, you should be able to compile the framework and have it work. If it doesn't use OpenGL-ES, there are a lot of OpenGL and OpenGL compatible functions, so it might still work. In our experience, there's a lot of OpenGL stuff that has worked, but there's some functions that don't exist in GL-ES that does in GL, so in general, you'd have to give it a try. But if it already runs on OpenGL-ES, you should have very little issues having it compile for our platform. Any more questions? So the question is whether there's any wrappers for OpenGL running OpenGL-ES underneath. So yes, there are wrappers. If you guys go to sourceforge.org, there is a wrapper. If I can remember the name, it's DGL-ES, I believe, or Dogless. Yeah, Dogless, I believe, is the name. And it will simulate OpenGL. API using OpenGL-ES. That tends to work reasonably well. There's some performance issues there, so I wouldn't necessarily recommend it. But if all you want to do is just get something up and running, then that's an avenue you can definitely use. We have tried it in the past, and we got a couple of stuff running that was completely written in OpenGL. So that is an option. Any more questions? Sure. OK, so the question is, what texture format do we prefer? So as far as the file format, it doesn't really matter, right? Because when you load a file format, you can load a PNG, you can load a BMP, you can load any file format with SDL image, actually, pretty much. And once you have that data, you need to push it to GL. Or if you don't use GL, you just use it with SDL directly. But the image file format itself is not so relevant. If you use GL, however, what you'll tend to find is that you'll be much better using a lower bit version, again, because it's memory bandwidth consumption. So if you have an image that you want to load in a 16-bit environment, you're going to be better off with a compressed texture or something that uses less memory in general is going to be more efficient, just because you're using less memory bandwidth. So that's the general rule. So if you can compress your texture, go for it. If you can run it in 16-bit versus 32, go for it as well. But if you need the quality of the visual, then clearly you can't compress it. Okay, so the question is related to the file format is which one is more efficient? So basically, it should not be any different than other platforms because the file format in general tends to be dictated by the decompression algorithms that you need to run and various things like that. So stuff like JPEG is going to be a bit more heavier duty on the CPU because it has to do DCT decompressions and various things like that. Whereas something like a BMP is really just a sheer reversal of the rows. So something like a BMP is going to load pretty quickly, assuming that flash is pretty fast from disk. But in general, what we tend to suggest for file formats is if you can preload all of those and keep them in memory, then you're going to be a whole lot better. So you're going to have an initialization cost, of course. But once that's all up and done, then you guys can just go and just rip it through. Sure. So the question is pretty much the same question, but related to audio. So what file format do we prefer in audio? So for audio, stuff like MP3 will play pretty well because it's hardware accelerated. So it goes through pretty well. The one thing we tend to say to developers in general for sound is if you can run at 22 kilohertz, that'll be pretty optimal because we don't have to resample or do anything like that. 44 is also a pretty friendly number. So those are my suggestions as far as audio is concerned. Any more questions? All right, so thank you.